ृभ्यो वंश ऋषिभ्यो महद्भ्यो नमो गुरुभ्यः सर्वोपप्लवरहितः प्रज्ञानघनः प्रत्यगर्थो ब्रह्मैवाहमस्मि ब्रह्मैवाहमस्मि ॐ शान्तिः 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 ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्तिः 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 ॐ ईशावास्यमिदं सर्वं यत्किञ्च जगत्यां जगत् तेन त्यक्तेन भुञ्जीथा माग्रधः कस्य स्विद्धनं कुर्वन्नेवेह कर्माणि जिजीविषेच्छतं समाः एवं त्वयि नान्यथेतोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे असुर्या नाम ते लोका अंधेन तमसा वृताः तांस्ते प्रेत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये के चात्महनो जनाः अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयो नैनद्देवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत् तद्धावतोऽन्यानत्येति तिष्ठत् तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति तदेजति तन्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्तिके तदन्तरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतान्यात्मैव भूद्विजानतः तत्र को मोहः कः शोक एकत्वमनुपश्यतः सपर्यगाच्छुक्रमकायमव्रणम् अस्नाविरं शुद्धमपापविद्धं कविर्मनीषी परिभूः स्वयं भूर्याथा तथ्यतोऽर्थान् व्यदधाच्छाश्वतीभ्यः समाभ्यः अन्धन्तमः प्रविशन्ति ये विद्यामुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो यौ विद्यायां रताः अन्यदेवाहुर्विद्यया अन्यदाहुरविद्यया इति शुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विचचक्षिरे विद्यां चाविद्याञ्च यस्तद्वेदोभयं सः अविद्यया मृत्युं तीर्त्वा विद्यया मृतमश्नुते अन्धन्तमः प्रविशन्ति ये सम्भूतिमुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमो यौ सम्भूत्यां रताः अन्यदेवाहुः सम्भवादन्यदाहुरसम्भवात् इति शुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विचचक्षिरे सम्भूतिञ्च विनाशञ्च यस्तद्वेदोभयं सः विनाशेन मृत्युं तीर्त्वा सम्भूत्यां मृदमश्नुते हिरण्मयेन पात्रेण सत्यस्यापि हितं मुखं त tattvam pushanna pavrinu satya dharmaya drushtaye pushanne karshe yama surya prajapatya vyuha rashmin samuhatejo yatte rupam kalyana tamam tatte pashyami yosavasau purushaha sohamasmi vayuranilamamritamathedam bhasmantagum shariram om kratosmara kritam smara kratosmara kritam smara om shantihi shantihi shantihi. So the next mantra which we are about to study talks about the good path, supatha, the good path. By the good path we understand the path of dharma. Now this word dharma, which has been one of the most important words ever to be used in ancient India, and I'm not only talking about the Vedic traditions, but also within Buddhism, within Jainism, within all the traditions that were in search of something deeper within. For them, the idea of dharma was extremely important. It is one of the three places of refuge. For example, in Buddhism, Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, Dhammam Sharanam Gacchami, Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, the middle one, the second one. The Buddha speaks about Dhamma, about Dharma. The Sanskrit word for it is Dharma. And that is why it is very difficult to translate this word into one English word, because so much has been talked about it, so much has been said about it, that simply one word won't do justice. But still, if we would try to translate it based on the grammatical construction of the word, then dhar, the root dhri, means to hold, to uphold. And therefore, the principles, the practices, the virtues, everything and anything that enables a person to hold himself, to raise himself up, all that can be called dharma. And that is, in fact, one of the definitions that Maharshi Kanada, the atomist amongst the ancient Indian philosophers, approximately 6th century BC, his definition of dharma is that which enables someone to rise like the sun rises. Abhyudaya, the word udaya has been used, which is the same word for suryodaya, sunrise. So that which enables an individual to rise and then attain what he calls nishreyasa, the best, the good in one's life. That is how he defines dharma. In the Vedic traditions, dharma cannot be understood simply by following one person's teaching. That would be very limited from a Vedic perspective. Therefore, a follower of the Vedic tradition would say that, unlike a Buddhist who has committed himself completely to Buddhism, he would say, yes, the Buddha expresses dharma, he expresses dharma, he expresses the laws of righteousness, he expresses sanatana dharma, the Sanskrit word for Hinduism actually. Sanatana dharma means the timeless dharma, the eternal dharma, the path of the eternal dharma. A Hindu would also agree that what the Buddha teaches is sanatana dharma, is the eternal aspect of dharma. However, the only thing that he would differ from a Buddhism would be that he cannot agree that only the teachings of the Buddha contain the complete dharma. Because in the understanding of the Vedic traditions, it cannot be one person, but it has to be a complete galaxy of stars, a complete galaxy of masters who have practiced throughout their lives and explored the various aspects of dharma and then presented it in their words. Sometimes these words express the same thing. Sometimes they also express differing opinions. So they are different, even opposing, mutually opposing voices. And somebody who wants to draw out the essence of dharma for his own life, he has to deal with these mutually opposing teachings and see where on the deeper level these seemingly opposite teachings unite into one essence, and that is where the essence of dharma lies. So this is the approach that someone would take in the Vedic tradition, and that is what has made the Vedic tradition very all-embracing, the same attitude we find, for example, in the teachings of modern Vedantins. Modern Vedantins, by that I mean the Vedantins that lived within the last 400, 500 years, where we find this tremendous acceptance also for other traditions, for Islam, for Christianity, for all the different traditions as genuine paths, but not accepting that that is the only difference between a Vedanti and a Christian, a Vedanti, a Muslim, that a Muslim would say that this is the only truth, and a Vedantin would say, yes, this is also the truth. That all-inclusiveness is only the only difference that is there. Because as the Vedas say, ekam sat, yes, the pure existence is one, but vipraha bahudha vadanti, the wise express it in various ways. So when the masters talk about supatha, it's not one particular path of somebody's teachings, but it is a very all-encompassing path in which a person, the goal of a person is to explore the reality within, the inner world of consciousness, the path that leads us to enter our heart. So that is known as the path of dharma, the path of righteousness, universal principles, universal laws, whatever, virtues, whatever we want to translate it. However, the masters have to give a practical means by which we, if we are faced with the dilemma that in this particular life circumstance, what would be dharma, what would be the correct thing to do, and what would be the incorrect thing to do, how to make that choice. For that, I'm talking about now the Vedic traditional position, that they have credentials, or means something which can be used to identify dharma. Yeah, prerequisites, or can't find the word that I want. Anyway, if it comes to my mind, I will let you know. You know, like like in Sanskrit we use the word touchstone to see if the gold is pure. In ancient times they had this touchstone, and then they used to take the gold and rub it, and by analyzing that impression, the goldsmiths could say whether the gold is pure or impure. So that is what I think in English is called touchstone. So something like that, to know whether this is the correct thing to do or not. So they have listed five things, and this is Yogi Yajnavalkya, also one of the great yogis and also a great Vedantin. The first thing, as is accepted in all the Vedic traditions, that to know dharma and to know Brahman. Dharma is the path and Brahman is the goal. Brahman, which means pure consciousness. Dharma, pure consciousness within, and dharma is the path that leads. To know these two things, the first thing that a person has to do is to study the teachings, to meditate on the teachings of those who have already walked on the path of dharma and have experienced pure consciousness. So it comes back to the Vedas, to the Shruti. That is the first way of analyzing. But the thing about the Shrutis is that the Vedic teachings generally never talk about practical rules and regulations, you know, do's and don'ts. You see what is there in the Upanishads. Very universal teachings, not specific teachings, but very universal, very general. It is about, for example, Manurbhava, become a good human being, follow the path of light. So the teachings are very general. But then what about the specific conduct? In the Vedic traditions, these specific conducts can never be universal. And they are never accepted to be divinely revealed. You know, by this I mean the social laws, the social customs, the social rules and regulations, how a person should get married, with whom they should get married, all these social rules, you know. Unlike in some of the other religions, for example, one of the biggest problems in Islam is that Sharia, that law, is really considered revealed by the divine. And therefore it becomes very difficult to change it, because it's divinely revealed. But such laws, such customs, which was the law of the nation before the modern constitution was formed, and even today some of the constitutions, for example the constitution of Burma, Thailand, still is based on these texts known as the Smritis, and they are considered of human origin, and they are place specific, country specific. They can change from country to country, even within country they change from group to group. And therefore all these rules, such as should a person be vegetarian or should a person be allowed to meat eat, and all these things, these are not discussed in the Vedas. In the Vedas we don't find such things, or whether a person is allowed to marry within their own family or they should marry with someone else. All these rules, and you find mutually opposing positions depending on the places where the customs belong. So those are known as the Smriti texts. They are considered of human creation, and they change from place to place. Even, yes, from time to time also. That is also there. There are some specific Smritis are considered belonging to a different era. Some Smritis considered belong to a different era. So they change from place to place, from time to time, from person to person. They are not universal. But the Vedas have the universal teachings. So these are the two groups of scriptures, the two collection of teachings, ancient teachings that underlie the Vedic path of dharma. The third thing is sadachara, looking at the conducts. Sadachara means looking at the conduct of noble persons. Because not all the different complexities of life can be expressed in teachings. We always are faced with new circumstances, and most probably there will be no solution or no teaching about that in the Vedas or in the Smritis. Then what to do? Then we can look at great persons of our times or great persons of ancient times, look at their lives, look at their auto, look at their biographies and see what they did, how they reacted under certain circumstances, and see if as ideals we can learn something from them. Also Patanjali in the Yoga Sutras, when he speaks about internal purification, he speaks about meditating on the lives of those who have transcended selfish attachment and hatred. He speaks about meditating on those. So to inspire. So that also allows us to know what is right and what is wrong, what should be, which path should be followed and what should be avoided. Again, these individual master saintly people in India are very region specific. Different regions of India have their own different collection of saints and sages, which some of them are respected throughout the country, some of them are deeply respected in one area but are completely unknown in other parts of the world, on other parts of India. So it all depended very much on the choice. The masters have given some definitions, some virtues of what is a saint, you know, that they should be very soft in their speak towards all, alukshaha dharma kamasyu, everything that they do should only be with a desire to follow dharma, and they should not be someone who is led or guided by somebody else, but they should be completely independent, following the call of their own heart. So such things have been few of the things which are just coming to my mind right now, I'm saying. So to see the conduct of such individuals, that is the third touchstone to understand dharma. And after that, the fourth and the fifth are very beautiful, that even sometimes we don't find an answer through these three. Then we should look in our own heart and we should try to listen to our own voice and think what will give me long-lasting satisfaction. What will be ultimately, but not pleasant in a momentary sense. The word that has been swasya cha priyam atmanah, that which is the most pleasant for yourself, that is the fourth one, but pleasant in a higher sense. Pleasant in a sense that which is soothing, relaxing, uplifting, making us feeling light, not heavy, suppressed or depressed, but that which enables us to feel very light. That is the correct course of conduct. And this is something that the masters apply to various things. You know, they say, for example, what is the sign that our asana practice was done properly today, that we feel completely light, elevated, relaxed deep within. The same thing has been said about austerity. What kind of austerity is the correct austerity? That which makes us feel light, soft, relaxed from within. The same has been said about proper study, proper meditation. You know, this rule has been applied in so many different places by the masters. This is the fourth one, swasya cha priyam atmanah. And then the fifth one is that analyze the action look at the desire that gives rise to that action, and see if that desire is rooted in proper resolution. If it is rooted in proper resolution, then the resulting desire is a good desire, and the resulting action will be an action within dharma. So this is the fifth definition in which the idea was taken to sankalpa, to samyak sankalpa, to correct resolution, to proper resolution, which then inspires proper desire, and proper desire then gives rise to proper action. So that is to go into the root, and this is not, somebody cannot understand our intention. Somebody cannot understand what our intention is. But basically what this means is that if the intention is correct, if the intention is to benefit others, if the intention is to selflessly serve others, if the intention is the best of others, then the resulting action will be also good, will also be within dharma. So that is why this idea of inner correct resolution, and yes, initially a person requires the Vedas to tell him what is right and what is wrong, the Smritis to tell him how he should live his life and not. He has to look at the masters, how they lived. But in the Vedic traditions, this idea is very strong, that when a person has reached a certain level of inner development, then there is no need for him or her to remain a servant of the scriptures. Shankaracharya expresses this idea very beautifully, that once a person has found that light within himself and follows that internal light, then the Vedic teachings, the Smritis, all the scriptures, they do not rule over him anymore, but they become like his servants. The very word that he uses is that they become his servants. What he does, the path that he follows, becomes the Vedic path. He does not have to check in the scriptures whether this is in accordance or not. And that is what Shankaracharya, for example, before he left his house in the pursuit of higher knowledge at the age of 5, he promised to his mother that he will come back the moment she needs him. And when she called him, he went back. By the time he was already one of the greatest master, the greatest scholar of his times. He had walked the width and breadth of the country, was declared already Sarvajna, which means omniscient, by seating him on the Sarvajna Pita, on the chair of the omniscient, which was in Kashmir, the great Sharada temple, the temple of Saraswati. So all that had happened, and after that, when she called for him, he left everything and he went to his mother to serve her in the last moments. And he imparted the deepest teachings to her in the last moments of her lives. And he remained with her till she left her body. And then after that, even did the cremation, because this was one of her wishes, that you are my only child, and if you become a sannyasi, if you become a monk, then you cannot do my cremation, then who will do my cremation? So then he had promised her that, you don't worry, I will do it. However, this is against the customs of that place and that time. So the Brahmins of that area became extremely angry. Being a monk, how could he first of all come back to his home, to his mother, and now he's serving his mother, and then eventually he does something that is completely prohibited. They excommunicated him from the family, to which the only answer before he left left was Nistraigunye Pathivijaratam Kovidhi Konishedha, which means that someone who follows the path that transcends the three gunas, sattva guna, rajoguna, and tamoguna, somebody who walks on, who has walked on that path, how can he be the subject of injunctions and prohibitions, external injunctions and prohibitions, because he follows the call of his heart? So like this, we find this openness in the teachings of the masters and the lives of the masters again and again. So these two last things, what is pleasant, soothing, relaxing, uplifting to us, that is the first thing. And then the second thing is to the kinds of actions that arise out of desires that are born out of correct resolution, proper resolution, samyak sankalpa. This discussion that we are having addresses that inner light which manifests within ourselves as correct resolution, that inner light. That is what was addressed in the previous mantra that we studied when the master said, O resolution, which means, O my internal light, which manifests in the form of resolution. So that prayer was to that. Because these were the two things that those masters who did not study the Vedas because they were the originators of the Vedas, they followed. They followed these two things, what was universally beneficial for them and for all, and what was rooted in correct resolution, in proper resolution. So this is, and that is what, for example, Patanjali would refer to as the internal master, as the internal guide, the timeless guide. You know, when he speaks about sapurvesham api guruhu, that internal purusha, that internal purusha simply means something that abides within the city of this body. So that light within, which was the master of also the most ancient masters, because it is not limited by time. That light is not limited by time. Patanjali, Dadhyang Atharvana, Krishna, all these persons, the Buddha, as a person, only as a person, not as their essential spirit, not as their essential being, but as the person, they are limited in time and in place. But this is the real master that is present within them and that also enlightened the most ancient master. So this prayer, the next mantra, is addressed to that inner light, which the masters sometimes use various words. Sometimes they use the word pura eta. Pura eta means guide. Pura eta, pura means ahead, and eta means walk. The one who walks ahead, that is what a guide does. When we have a guide, we allow the guide to... So for the Vaidic rishis, the guide is light. They used this word for the light. Or for example, one of the statements that the luminous beings found no other messenger and guide than the light. The light is also seen as the messenger because it brings the message of consciousness within. It enables us to understand. When we meditate on light, on external physical light, it enables us to understand the light of consciousness. In that sense, it is a messenger, and it is also a leader. It also leads us on the path of righteousness. Sometimes the light is even called Pathikrit, the path maker. Krit means maker, and Pathi means path. So the path maker, the one who makes the path by walking on it. So that is, these are the adjectives that the Vedic rishis use for Agni, for light. And of course, when they mean the light, they are not speaking about any external light somewhere out there, but they are speaking about a light which, in the words of the Upanishads, is what is the past participle of bear? Born. Okay, yeah. So in that sense, not birth, but the light that is born by all within their hearts, but of which the yogis become aware, which all of us bear within us, like the example that has been given there, is like a pregnant mother bears the child within her. You know, garbha iva subhrito garbhini bhihi. Very happily, pleasantly, with delight, she carries with all her affection, she carries with all care. You know, in those 9 months, she wouldn't jump, she wouldn't do these things, because she cares about it. So everything that she does is to take care of that light, so this, that child. So the same thing, a yogi holds that. Usually we are unaware of it, but once we become aware of it, then everything we do in our life is to create and to remain aware of that internal light. Dive deva idyaha, they sing its glory every day, and jagrivad bhihi, and meditate on it by waking up, by becoming awakened. This is one of the Upanishads, Kathopanishad. Uses this expression. So it is this, that is why later masters say that one can worship God in 6 different places. According to the Vedic traditions, you can worship God, you can worship the omnipresent divinity. Though it is omnipresent, but for the sake of worship, you have to choose one place where you can direct your attention. So the masters say, water, because water is the very source of life and all purification. So we worship the omnipresent divinity in water because of its purifying essence. The whole idea of Tirtha in India, today Tirtha in Hindi is thought to be a pilgrim place. For example, Rishikesh is Tirtha. But the original meaning in Sanskrit is actually a sacred body of water, a clean body of water. That's all what Tirtha means. Tirtha has nothing to do with the place. It has to do with water. Because where people came for purification, where they worshipped, when there were no temples, no statues, nothing, just standing within the water, they offered water to the divinity present within water, which purifies our being. So the first thing, water. Then the second place where the omnipresent divinity is worshipped is fire. You know, in the fire pit. We had this in all the different religions and cultures around the globe, where because fire as light was taken as a symbol to that divinity, many of the temples, ancient temples, even today, the lamp that is there, the candle that is there, symbolizes that ancient tradition of worshipping the omnipresent divinity within this earthly manifestation of light, fire, the second thing. The third thing is the heart. That is the third place where the omnipresent divinity is worshipped. Apsu agnau hridaye surye. And then in this source of life and light, which is the sun, which rises every day, and which is in a way really the source of life and the sustainer of life, and then also the destroyer, the assimilator of life. So that is the fourth. It's not that they were worshipping the sun, but they were worshipping the omnipresent divinity within the sun. So that is the fourth one. The fifth one is a mandala. Mandalas are these mystical diagrams which have deep, where each and every line and edge and color and everything has a deep mystical or philosophical significance. And such mandalas again exist in all traditions, at least in all traditions of Southeast Asia. So mandala is the fifth one, and the sixth one is a statue, pratima, which simply means an image, something that is in a way similar to what, it's not that, but it is something in a way, in its symbology, in the symbols that have been used, it represents an aspect of that formless, nameless divinity. So that is called pratima. Pratima means upama, something that is similar to that. The Sanskrit word for statue is pratima, something that is very similar, similar. So these things. And there is an interesting quotation that who worships the divinity where? Those who perform fire rituals, they worship the divine in fire. Agnau kriyavatam devaha. The great theologians, the philosophers, they meditate on the divine as being present in the heaven, up there, in the heaven. And the ignorant ones, those with a very limited understanding, they meditate on the same divine as being present within a statue. Those who have still a very limited and a very, very narrow outlook of the divine, but still very limited understanding, they worship the divinity in a statue. But the yogis, the meditators, because yoga means meditation, yoginam hridaye harihi, the yogis, they worship and meditate upon that within their hearts. So when the yogis, they understand these mantras, then the light is not some external light in the sense of a physical light. It is not even a light which is somewhere up there, higher up in some heaven. That would be the second level of interpretation of the Vedic mantras. The deepest, the third, the internal, the yogic interpretation of a Vedic mantra is to apply the essence of the teaching within our own self. And that is the path of a yogi, in which he is in search of the light within himself. That is the path of a yogi. So this next mantra is addressed to that Agni, to that light within. The time is nearly over. Let me just finish this session by saying something about this mantra. We'll not pronounce the mantra today. We will do that in our next session. But this mantra is a very strange mantra. In the original version of Ishavasya Upanishad, because Ishavasya Upanishad, like the Veda itself, of which the Ishavasya Upanishad is the 40th chapter, the Shukla Yajur Veda, has two recensions. One is known as the Madhyandina recension, and the other one is known as the Kandva recension. Kandva recension is based on the name of a great rishi, Maharshi Kandva, the caretaker of Shakuntala, whose son was Bharata, and on whose name this country is called Bharata. Shakuntala, because Shakuntala, she is the heroine of one of the greatest works of literature in Sanskrit language, translated in all the different languages of the world by Kalidas. And so he's her caretaker. He found her as a young, as a baby in the forest, being taken care of by birds, and then he brought her back to his home, and he took care of her, and she grew up under his wings. So he was a great rishi, Maharshi Kanva. So the recension according to him is Kanva recension. This is the one that we are studying. However, there is another Shukla Yajur Veda, which is most probably more ancient than this recension, which is not named on particular person. It simply means, the name is Madhyandina recension, and Madhyandina recension means the recension that was received from the sun, from the midday sun. That is what it means. Now, whatever that means, it is just a name. It has, again, we can see that it has a deep symbolical meaning. But in that recension, the last mantra that I have placed here, this is the last mantra in place of this one. This one that we are about to study, this is absent. And this small one, Kham Brahma, which means pure consciousness is infinite space, is there in place of this mantra. So one recension has this mantra and the other recension has that mantra. So I have taken both mantras because both are very beautiful. So you won't find, that is why you won't find this mantra in most of the Ishavasya Upanishads, because most of the Ishavasya Upanishads that have been printed follow that recension, not the ancient one. Because the relatively modern one was made famous by Shankaracharya by writing commentary Shankaracharya. Why Shankaracharya chose that recension? Because he was born in a family that followed that recension. And so you would obviously study and comment on that which belongs to your own family. So that is the only reason why he chose the modern one and not the ancient one. But because he chose that one became more famous, and the ancient one is basically unknown. So this mantra, the last one, the Om Kham Brahma, is there in the place of this mantra that we are about to study in the ancient one. And that is why we know that this mantra actually does not belong to this section. And that is why it is not seen by the same seer of the Ishavasya Upanishad. So till now, I was always speaking about Dadhyang Atharvana as the seer of Ishavasya Upanishad, as the master of Ishavasya Upanishad. Dadhyang, the son of Atharva, I told about him a little bit in the beginning of this discussion last year. But now the seer of this mantra is somebody else. It is not Dadhyang Atharvana. It is somebody, another great rishi called Agastya. His name is Agastya. And Agastya is a great name not only in India, but even today in Burma, in Laos, in Thailand, Cambodia, ancient Malaysia, Vietnam, and Indonesia. In all these Southeast Asian countries, even today, for example, if you go to the beautiful temples of Angkor Wat and Prambanan, Angkor Wat in Cambodia, Prambanan in Java, in Yogyakarta in Java, you find these beautiful statues of Maharshi Agastya. And as a dwarf, small little rishi, he was not tall, he was dwarf, and big belly, pot bellied, that is how he is usually depicted. And his wife, who was originally a princess, loved him and got married to him against the wish of her father, because her father did not want her to get married to him, but she loved him. Lopa Mudra, as her name is, and there are statues of both of them, Lopa Mudra and Agastya. And he and she, both of them, she is a great rishika and he is a great rishi, and there are various mantras in the ancient Rig Veda, the most ancient collection of teachings, and some of these mantras are even little bit problematic, in the sense problematic for modern people, because what happened is that they were having a private dialogue in their own room, and this was heard by their student who was standing outside, and so that was collected also in the Rig Veda. You know, so it's a very private dialogue that you would expect between a husband and a wife. And even that, because he heard it, it was collected, even in the Rig Veda. So they are very interesting figures, highly respected in South India, because he was the first grammarian of Tamil literature, of Tamil language, the master of the Siddhar. Siddha medicine and all these traditions, the Siddha traditions of South India, they originate in Agastya. Agastya is the original fountainhead. And he was the key person who united North India and South India thousands and thousands of years ago. Before that, India was limited by the Himalayas in the north and the Vindhya Mountains, which cross India in the middle. You know, and the southern part of India, which juts out into the ocean, you know, the Bay of Bengal on this side, the Arabic Sea and the Indian Ocean, that part was like, you know, the part of the barbarians, the part of the uncivilized, you know. That was the outlook that was there. And this area between the Himalayas and between the Vindhya Mountains, between these two mountains, was known as Aryavarta, the land of the Aryas, you know, the land of the civilized ones. So what he did, he moved across the Vindhya Mountains. He left Aryavarta, he left the holy land, the so-called holy land, and went into the south. And with him took all the wisdom to the south, and he inspired great literature, great knowledge, great wisdom. And in that we really united after that, this division between south and north never existed, despite the customs being very different. Even today, South Indian customs are very different from North Indian customs. Still, they started to look upon themselves as one people, one person. Until recently now, politics again has created this linguistic division. But so he was a great unifying force, a highly respected person, figure, as I stated. Even Shankaracharya, in one of his while commenting on one of the shlokas in the Bhagavad Gita, he says that the Brahmins are today respected only because they claim to be the descendants of Agastya. That is why. So, you know, so the reason that they are respected today is because they were the descendants of Agastya. Another symbolic story, but there are so many different, but because I mentioned his pot belly, you know, because there is this mythological story of him drinking the ocean in three. He took the three sips, yes. So he, that is, it's a mythological story that in three sips he drank the ocean. Of course, yogis have interpret this differently. They say that what is the ocean? The ocean is citta. Citta meva hi samsaram. This ocean of thought contents that is within us, which is infinite like the ocean. You know, and the reason he had to drink away that ocean was that some demons were hiding it. So they used to come out of that ocean, they used to kill the luminous beings, destroy the luminous beings, and then run back into the ocean and save themselves by hiding in the ocean. So what he did, he just drank the ocean so that those demons could have been eliminated. And these are our vices, you know, that come from, are hidden within our citta, come from there, suddenly come up, destroy everything that we have built up, you know, and then again go back. So by now always looking at the time, but Patanjali, the way he explains asamprajñata samadhi, the deepest states of meditation, presents a beautiful parallel, actually, and a beautiful explanation to this symbolical story about Agastya. So he is what sometimes modern Indologists call a semi-mythical being. You know, there are some stories which can obviously be about his life, but then there are also stories which are mythologies, and of course, from a Vedantic perspective, when we are faced with a mythology, then we always look for a deeper significance, what it tries to convey. So basically, a Vedantin would say that he was a deep meditator. He had reached one of those ancient rishis who had reached the deepest levels of meditation, as systematically explained by Patanjali. So we'll come back to this mantra in our next session. This was a little information about the rishi, the master of this mantra, and why the master of this mantra is somebody else than the master of the other mantras. So any questions? Yes. Exactly, this other recension, the Kandva recension.
Even how did it attach to that recension?
The masters within that recension, for some, they obviously, they must have had a reason. And you can see the reason is clear, because the whole context is meditation on light. And this last mantra just expresses something very important that has been left out. You know, so those masters decided to add it because it beautifully fits into the context. It is in continuation, and there is nothing, no harm in it. It adds something to what has already been said, because it emphasizes, it really brings us actually to yoga, because it emphasizes the importance of choosing the correct path in one's life and to work to remove the impurities or the agitating thoughts. We will discuss what impurities mean. To remove them, to work, and that requires practical work. This cannot be done by philosophizing or just by thinking or by scholarly endeavor, but it really requires action. It requires hard work, which is what we saw in the very beginning in the teachings of Ishavasya Upanishad in the second mantra, where he emphasized on hard work, and we see how he kept on emphasizing on hard work in various passages. And it brings us back really to the idea of karma yoga, to the very foundation of hard work, the importance of hard work. So, yeah, so it's according to this recension, the Kandva recension, it is there. And like this, the whole Veda, in all the 40 chapters, and there are these various recensions, some of them have survived, about some we just hear, and they have these slight differences. Maybe some word might be pronounced differently or like this. Differences are there. Because these things were preserved in memory, and so some such changes. But then these changes were faithfully preserved as well. So then you can always check. You know, you can, as we see now, we have also the other recensions. So you can always check what has come in. But it has not come in from an unauthentic origin. We also know the origin from where it has come. So like this.
This final mantra is very similar to a prayer.
Yeah.
The Vedas and the Vedanta, the form of prayer isn't very common.
Isn't very common, yes. Yes.
The difference, I mean, number 16, of mantra 16 is also a little bit, but number 18 is
very clearly,
very it's a prayer.
It's a prayer.
That's
yes.
Where it's a bit different.
And that is why
so
it is.
It may be a nice conclusion, but somehow, yeah. I mean, I'm curious to hear when you talk about it, you explain it clearly, but reading it here, just the translation, it sounds like a prayer, which is actually a little bit unusual.
Yeah. It is a Rig, you know, because it is a mantra from the Rig Veda. The most, Yajurveda is the second most ancient one. You find this mantra originally already in the most ancient, yes. Just this one, not the others. Just this one is found there. It has been taken from there, from the original ancient collection. So there it is called, from there we know that the seer of this mantra is Agastya, because it is part of a hymn which was seen by him, by Maharshi Agastya. So, and Rig, the mantras from the Rig Veda, because it is a collection of Rig, therefore the mantras of the Rig Veda are called Rig or Richa. And Rig means a prayer. Yes, Rig means through which you worship. Yes, yeah. So which you use in worshiping, in meditation, you know, like a eulogy or how?
Eulogy.
Yeah, something like this, yeah. I don't know, sorry, no. The wrong word. Yeah, liturgy, yes, like a liturgy, yes, that's the word that I was searching, yes, liturgy, not eulogy, but liturgy. Yeah, so that is what Rig means, while Sama is more like the Psalms, you know, so Rig are like liturgical, which were sung, you know, during the worship sessions of the light in the form of the fire.
A hymn.
Yes, it's a hymn. Any other comment? Yes. Yeah, I mean, as I pointed out, for them,
yeah,
for them, diversity, to preserve the diversity, was very important. You see that already. This quotation, that is why I've taken this quotation from the Rig Veda, from the most ancient collection of teachings. That yes, the truth is one, but the wise express it in various ways. And to preserve those various expressions of the same truth as they experienced it, but expressed it differently depending on the place, time, and language they spoke, to preserve that diversity was extremely important. And I see that is why, for that reason, today, Hinduism is an extremely confusing religion, because you don't have one position. You don't have, okay, this is the official position of Hinduism. This is simply not possible. If somebody claims, then he's just claiming it according to his own tradition and upbringing. But a completely opposite position could be there in another tradition. So there is nothing like that. So in a way, it is more like a general assembly or like a parliament, you know, where everybody has their own voice, and everybody has to be heard and everybody has to be respected, even if they are saying, there are even within the Vedas themselves, can you believe, there are voices which clearly doubt claims such as the other world, you know, heaven after death, who knows whether there will be a heaven after death or not. Or such skeptical positions, you know, Veda, Yadivana Veda, who knows if they know or they don't know, or even if the Creator knows or not. You know, so you find these skeptical positions, and they have been expressed. So very differing positions, sometimes it becomes very confusing what to follow. But to me, that is the most beautiful thing. Because then you can incorporate, you know, You can see beyond that diversity. And I think that is the beautiful thing. That is the natural way of being. It is not a superficial, imposed, uniformity or something. I don't know if that's the correct word. You know, when you want everything to be one and the same, everyone should say the same thing, everyone should believe the same thing, everyone should follow that superficial uniformness of the society.
That's why you can't really compare Vedanta to the religion.
Yeah.
You were saying before about the Muslim religion, Christian religion, they have that one way, but they were religions.
Yeah, they were religions. Vedanta is not a religion. In that sense, Vedanta is not.
It helps you go beyond religion.
Yes.
It's the key to go beyond all of that. You know, it's limitless.
Yes.
Yes. The rest of them somehow, it's a key, but they lock the door.
They lock the
door. You're stuck inside.
Yes.
Vedanta is on the other side, unlocks the door. Walk. Then, of course, it's up to us to walk out of the door. But it definitely opens the door.
It definitely opens
the door. Or at least a window,
Yes.
Crack it open a little bit.
Yes.
So, thank God that never happened,
Yeah. And that is why, all the masters had to deal with these opposing positions, and initially it can be a little bit confusing, and that is why the idea of sampradaya, first of all, just to follow one's tradition, because if you have all the instructions on one posture, Ashtanga yoga teaches this, Iyengar yoga teaches this, Hatha yoga teaches that, all the instructions, it will be confusing. So we follow one path just for the sake of focus, but then we can grow beyond it, we can assimilate, we can learn the best from everybody. Okay, so let us conclude. Om Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, Sarve santu niramayah, Sarve bhadrani pashyantu, Ma kaschid dukha bhag bhavet. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi.